She has been an adjunct professor of social entrepreneurship at Stanford for 15 years and has taught at Columbia Business School. In the past, she worked as a key account executive for AT&T, as a global account manager in her 14 years at JP Morgan, and as a Peace Corps volunteer. For her work, she was named the 2015 PBS News Shore Agent for Change and the SOCAP Entrepreneur in 2011, as a Fast Company Innovator Agent before that. Fun fact, our distinguished professor also speaks four languages. So please give it up for Melanie.
So I'm pinch hitting today. As you guys saw, we had a cancellation, so I'll strive to make it a fun game, and we won't go into overtime, right? So, but I want to really make it participatory too, and make it more of a conversation with you folks. So, as Paula mentioned, I've been running. So this, my night job, if you will, has been being an adjunct here at Stanford. But it was also where Stanford, where Mobile Metrics kind of started really percolating in my head. I was a digital vision fellow here for Reuters years back. And that's what I'm going to talk to you about today. And actually, I'm going to limit my conversation to 30 minutes because I really, really want to make it a conversation and have a lot more questions with you guys. Because there's some things we're up to at Mobile Metrics that I also love to brainstorm with you and use this as an opportunity. It's not just good for you guys, but also for Mobile Metrics as we create the next phase. So Mobile Metrics, really, I'll tell you what it's about and where it kind of got its origins besides Stanford. And a lot of Stanford folks on the team, but it really began at a visit in this community in Rio de Janeiro, a favela, right? Which is also a word for an inner city slum, although I don't like using that term because it seems very derogatory. These are really vibrant communities and oftentimes more innovative than we'll ever see in our country. I took a visit here, and when I came out of the community, I ended up asking a government worker who worked in communities how many people lived in Morro dos Macacos. And I was told there were 5,000. Okay. Later that same day, I met with some other entity with the government, with a health entity, and they told me 60,000 people lived in Morro dos Macacos. And so the moment of, oh my gosh, I probably said something different than that, but the fact that we could be 55,000 people off in one community really rattled me. Because, just to give you a context, Rio de Janeiro has about 1,000 favelas. That's one city. Have you guys heard of the term base of the pyramid? Right? Base of the pyramid. BOP is what they also call it. It's basically saying that take the population of the world. What's the estimated population of the world, more or less?
7 billion.
About 7 billion. They're even predicting it's going to be close down to 7.6, right? So let's just say 7 billion, rounding it. Somewhat rounding it, not really, but anyway. The base of the pyramid is anybody who really, and this is kind of World Bank, Financial Times, United Nations lingo, but it's people that live on less than $1,500 a year, right? So you can imagine, guess how, what the quantity is of this? We're talking 4 billion. Now, again, that's a World Bank estimate. I'll get to that in a second. But the fact that we could have, you know, 60% of our population that is considered base of pyramid is staggering. A guy named C.K. Prahalad, anybody heard of C.K. Prahalad? He was at the University of Michigan, wrote a book called The Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid back in about 2006. He projected that of this 4 billion, if you aggregate that as a market and look at the disposable income, you have over a $5 trillion market. $5 trillion, that's bigger than the other markets combined. The issue is how do you crack the code on reaching that market? I put that there because that's one school of thought. Now let's get back to the favela at Morro dos Macacos and how we could be off that many people, right? So that really was the question that kind of kept me awake at night, was because I know we were so, 55,000 people off potentially, that means, and that's just a head count, right? That's just like number of people here in the room, so to speak. But if they could be that far off on that, how far off are they in knowing and understanding their needs and their wants, their habits and their behaviors, their perceptions, their attitudes, and knowing about what they do lack, which is usually education, healthcare, but not knowing how far they're off on what, electricity, sanitation, some of the basics, right? So again, if you blow that out, we've got a huge issue. A huge issue if you're a government, because you're obviously putting your money into those numbers, right? That the World Bank numbers that I mentioned. But also could be a huge issue for foundations, who might be putting billions of dollars into solving malaria, but not really knowing what size of malaria that is. So the bottom line is, it just became really apparent in that moment that we've got an issue here. We have a lot of numbers. We dove down further, and what kept me awake at night was, again, this question. How can we serve a population if we don't know who they are, right? How can we serve a population and do it well and effectively? Whether you be a business, whether you be a foundation, whether you be a government, if you don't know who they are and what they need. So that just really ate at me for a long time. And I thought, well, of course, back to this World Bank numbers, right? Let's go to the World Bank and see how they get their data. Because obviously they have the world as their constituency, right? They have an interest. So in sitting down with the CIO of the World Bank and peeling back on how they got the numbers was another aha. How do you think the World Bank comes up with their numbers? And their numbers are everywhere, guys, right? If you've done any secondary research, right? How do you think they come up with their numbers?
They ask the governments who are wrong.
And, well, right.
Or
yes.
Inaccurate.
So they're asking the governments who are the World Bank's clients. They're not allowed to go anywhere else to get the data. They're only allowed to get it from the federal governments, which are their clients. Okay, drill down a little bit now. Where does the federal government get their data? Take a country. Where does that, World Bank relies on that federal government, whether it be Bangladesh, whether it be, Botswana,
census.
Germany.
Census.
Okay, census. And who administers that census?
In Brazil, it's the Institute of Geography. In Brazil,
you're Brazilian. Yeah.
Oh
boy. Okay, I'm on hot seat now. There's two in the room. So okay, but who actually does the count?
So I had a lot of friends who work there. Like they usually hire people fresh out of college. They go, they have a little machine. They go to their communities. Mm-hmm. They have to do a set number of interviews every day. There's like big.
And who's hiring them?
People who I know were hired by the institute on like 2-year contracts.
Right. Okay. So yeah, typically the federal government either outsources it and or they send it. But it's still being managed by the government, right? Even if it's outsourced.
Yeah.
So by the municipal government, and then when we even went further to find out, like the Bolsa Familia, that one. That was similar to a census, but they're really looking a bit more at financial needs and necessity in order to determine whether it be grants for education, that type of thing, right, to tie to school. But even that is goes one more level to the subprefectura, which is, there's a municipal and then there's the sub-municipal or the district, right? So you see where I'm coming. And then we get down there and ask the subprefecturas, at least in the case of Brazil, and it's true for many other countries, how do they get their data? We find that oftentimes they weren't even going into the communities, the Morros dos Macacos. And you know what, probably, right? Go ahead, what would be some of your reasons why you wouldn't go into?
It's dangerous.
And why is it dangerous?
Because, I don't know the case of this place specifically, but it's usually controlled by criminals. So
one reason is, you're right, the danger. It's often riveted with drug gangs.
It's hard to reach as well. Like, usually a blind, not very easy to discern. houses, families, and requires some local knowledge to get to another place.
Right, you can imagine trying to navigate this, right? There are no roads. It's like paths, steps, whatever. So and that's another reason, right? So there's a combination. Those are the two key reasons, though, are because it's difficult to navigate, also because of the bit of the gangs, the police raids that also happen. So it's kind of a fragile environment, especially if you're not from that area. So if you were someone from a government walking in, it's kind of can be very dangerous, right? So it doesn't happen. And so a lot of these estimates and a lot of these numbers, which were just, the second aha, were basically being gathered off of old data, sometimes 10 years old and projected, or just estimated, you know, or totally off. So that was kind of the, looking around who was helping to work on that issue, this question, and finding really very few people, or who we did find were organizations that were very siloed. A lot of nonprofits gather data, but they tend not to share it. It's very much siloed data. Corporations, some do, some aren't really interested, because again, they're kind of the belief that there's not a market, perhaps, there, so why bother getting data? You would think that governments would, but for the reasons that we were talking about, they get so far, you know, to the entryway and then just kind of balk, you know? I've been with government workers who refused to go in, refused, even though that was their job, was to work in those communities. So it's that kind of thing. There's a lot of kidnappings and things, too, in a lot of these communities. And I'm generalizing to Brazil, but it's true in a lot of countries. South Africa with the townships, India, not as much, but there's certainly crime there as well. And it's pretty rampant. So kind of that was the context of the issue. Now, some of the things that we ended up coming up with and trying to solve it was create a company that would basically generate market insights for marginalized communities so that those insights could help connect the communities with critical or essential or life-improving products and services. And how we did it was what was a little different. But before I go there, I just wanted to talk about those are some of the services today. Wasn't what we started with, but what today is what we offer for, who we offer them to would be to corporations, governments, nonprofits, foundations. We work with universities as well. With the whole objective of, yes, you guys want data, we'll get you data, but as you'll hear in a moment, we have a contingency on that and condition, because we want to make it a win-win with the community so that the community also benefits. Our core, what we started with though, and this is kind of part of the class, is kind of talk about the evolution of a journey, right? We started just with the primary research. And how that worked was this. We wanted to make sure it was organic and it was ground up, that it was by the people and for the people. So we really implemented a scheme where we would hire, train, and certify young adults from those communities to essentially go door to door with mobile phones and collect the data. And what that ended up being is they were easy to get into these communities, they were trusted, and this was such a great leadership opportunity for them as well. And we got more data than you can imagine. Because you can imagine sitting, if someone from your community comes and talks to you, you're almost like more relaxed and more open to share about your life. In the initial days, it almost was an issue because they were, when we first started, they were coming back really late from the field, and da 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 da. We found out it's because everyone wanted to offer lunch to them, or a cafezinho, or you know, a coffee, or you know, da 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 da. You know, and you know, we started like having to say, yeah, you can do lunch with them, but maybe on the weekend, right? To kind of set it up. So that was kind of the structure. And then I mentioned this bit about giving back, making sure it wasn't just strip mining for data, going into strip mining, but making sure there's something giving back to the residents. So we negotiate with every one of our clients, and this is a non-negotiable. In order for them to work with us, they have to make sure there's a social return of an information, a product, and service that goes back to the person who participates and to the community as a whole. And we'll give some examples here in just a second. So those are the three core parts of what we do that spread across all of our services. But the key to emphasize that I think is really the magic are these mobile agents. And that it's by the community, for the community. And the accuracy of the data, we Because at the end of the day, guys, it's all about accuracy of data, right? Because if it's trash in, it's trash out, right? No matter if you're using a, you know, your mobile, if it's trash in, it's trash out. So we're like, we're really obsessed with how can you get the most accurate data in? And we found that the probably the best quality control is A, how we select the mobile agents, and B, how we train them. Somebody just demonstrated, Unilever was one of our clients in Brazil, and I'm just going to show a 2-minute video to give you an idea of how this actually worked in action, if I was able to get there.
The project Open Doors, Knowledge from Within, created a bridge between Unilever and these consumers by establishing a relationship of respect and trust. In partnership with Mobile Metrics, local young adults were equipped with cutting-edge technology and trained to understand the hygiene habits of slum residents and how these individuals feel about their communities. In the focus of the research were women who were family home providers of 4 communities. In Rio Rocinha, Brazil's largest slum, with a population of over 80,000, and Morro dos Macacos, one of the city's most violent slums, with a population of 19,000. In Recife, Chão de Estrelas, located in the outskirts of the city with a population of over 28,000, and Brasília Teimosa, a slum nearby upscale neighborhoods, with a population of approximately 25,000. 86 mobile agents conducted the door-to-door data collection. 16,520 Lifebuoy soaps were distributed, in addition to educational brochures and flyers for the entire family. 16 lectures on hygiene were held, including a raffle of 1,200 Purette water filters. 4,130 homes were reached. A pioneering initiative of Unilever Brazil with Mobile Matrix.
Criamos modelo novo para a Unilever Brasil, que é escalável para outras comunidades, sempre respeitando a cultura local. E fizemos isso atuando em parceria com os próprios moradores, que foram treinados para entrevistar e ensinar a seus vizinhos atos de higiene. Essa relação de proximidade com a comunidade nos permite legitimar a entrada da mulher, tanto para novas pesquisas quanto para atuar com o seu comércio, o que é uma importante vantagem competitiva, dado o crescimento do poder econômico desse consumidor.
So what were the results of this particular project in Brazil? We looked at impacts for Unilever and then impacts for the community. Again, we want to create a win-win, and that's really important that we're measuring both, right? We're kind of walking that line. For Unilever, one of the keys was it underscored real market opportunity. They had a tremendous surge in their brand awareness for their products. The two products, Lifebuoy, which is an antibacterial soap, and Purette, which they don't manufacture Purette here in this country, but in Brazil it's a water purifier they manufacture there. And then 3 other things, although there's only mentioning 2. They revamped their marketing messages, they restructured their distribution based on all the data and the information insights they got. And to me, and it didn't show up on the slide, but one of the greatest significant increases I saw was the fact that they went back to the drawing board and redesigned the Purette water filter so that it could actually be appropriate for the community. And again, this was all because of feedback from the customer and the community. And then on the impact for the communities, again, what really changed in there? We were looking at behavioral changes, not really, that would be more like outputs versus outcomes. We couldn't measure if there's a health change given the time frame, but we could measure if there's a behavioral change. So we saw really significant increases in the amount of times they washed their hands as well as their treatment of water. Yes.
So after you partner with a client to do a survey, do you then share that data with the relevant government agency or?
Yeah, great question. So there's always a before and after. That's where we get the impact results, right? And we have 3 layers in the questionnaire. There's the top line, what we call public data. So if there's an urgency, for example, when we did a project with Johnson & Johnson, the government thought there was a 4% infection rate, and we found a 22% infection rate. That, obviously, for ethical reasons, goes public, right? And the client knows that. We circle those questions beforehand, and those are determined. So there's one part is that. The second part is what we call proprietary data. which it tends to be more of the client's competitive data, you know, on the brand awareness and or, you know, whose product they like over another person's product, another company's product. We negotiate to hold that data for 1 year, and the client has always agreed because that gives them a jump start, but then it comes back into Mobile Metrics as a Republic entity. And then the third layer of data, which is my favorite, is the community leader's data. We always ask every community leader to add 5 or 6 questions of their own. It could be on any topic, that's tagged on, and that goes back to the community leader in addition with the top line data. Just one other thing we got into because of this project with Unilever, which we hadn't thought of before, was immersion. So that's a picture of Paul Pullman, the CEO. After this data got out there and their country used this for X, Y, or Z reasons, Mr. Pullman came and did a walkthrough in the favela, ended up spending 4 hours, would have stayed longer, but the security guards were moving him on. That's a whole different conversation. That gave me an ulcer, but we literally got him to sign a waiver and his team and all the 12 security guards who were like to sign and say they would not come in with any arms, which he normally travels, was our first question before we agreed to this. He travels in an armed car and with armed guards because of, again, all the kidnapping stuff, but that's a whole other story over dinner or whatever. But the fact is he spent 4 hours going to meet with some of the consumers in their homes as well as some of the commercial entities, and that just touched me very deeply that someone and all his Latin America team that he brought with him would take so much interest to really understand what people want and need, make the data come alive. So the power of the immersions, I think, is something not to underestimate. Do you have a question?
Yeah, I was wondering if you had, if you could talk a little bit about ROI or just some information about how much Unilever would be able to sell these devices and gain afterwards.
We're still waiting for those numbers to come in. But they're in the process now of revamping the distribution channel to make it where they weren't before able to get as access, which was something that surprised me, really. I thought their distributors would have had the access. But this is now kind of blown up and opened a whole channel for them. Basically, when we asked them why they wanted to do it, they kept doing more work with us. And they said, I said, was it the data, the insights? They said, no, it wasn't even that. It was the unprecedented access, which is based on a trust, which gets back to who we choose to do work with. And we have to be very cautious about that. And I can talk about that too in Q&A if you guys want, about who we had to say no to, because we didn't feel like that's kind of channel. But back to Unilever and ROI, we're looking now to see how this new distribution channel, which is engaging the community to actually sell the products, is going to play out on their bottom line. I would just say these are the three things that kind of, you know, first is a lot of people do consumer research. Not so many are doing consumer research at the base of the pyramid. And we hope to change that. We're kind of a movement to say, wait a minute, guys, there is a market here. We need to be listening. And this is a way to listen and give them a voice. So I would love to have more competition, because how are we ever going to reach 4 billion people if we're not? And it's, people are starting to come into this space, which is great, because we need to show that, have these voices at the table that are helping design the products. Because usually corporations just take a product and strip it down and then try to push it onto this market. And that's it needs to be engaged from the get-go at the board level and at the R&D level, these voices and these people. And then the marketing tool and the social return, that's kind of the two bells and whistles that we added on, that again, making sure it's not just going in a strip mine, but there's a social return, right? That it really impacts the community. But that's also building the trust and the relationship, right? So I want to just talk a moment about our journey, because it wasn't always this way, how we started here at Stanford. There are so many failure stories I can tell you guys about if you want to hear, from what we've been designing our own software at the beginning to targeting government at the beginning. No offense to the Brazilian government, but boy, was that a challenge, you know? I think that we ended up pivoting and going to corporations to get the, you know, pretty much the same data and much faster with a, you know, I think some governments in general don't want to know the stuff that we pull out and the stuff that we start end up spotlighting. So that's another thing. But how we started was, you can see there on the left, Claudio here has a, he's using one of those palms. Remember the palms? probably don't even remember those, but that was in the early, right in the early days. It was the first time that really these handhelds were being used to collect data. And as we started doing the research from door to door to door to door, observing, hearing the mobile agents come back and telling us what they saw, what they felt, we started having a lot of aha moments. So my coaching to you guys is if you have an idea that you want to take out into the world, jump out there and prototype it, because that's where you learn. That's where we learn so much. And because we were starting to get so intimate in these homes and had that kind of access, a lot of ideas that only enriched, I think, the service later came to be. And that's where we kind of realized, my gosh, that's where the aha came about the doorstep social return. I mean, we're already on these hard-to-reach doorsteps. Why not, you know, basically take advantage and do something for the people instead of just, again, extracting the data and saying, ciao, right? And that's where this is the Johnson & Johnson where they're doing the anti-mosquito repellent. Here they're actually giving information on how to prevent. Again, we partnered, the government gave us literature, visuals about how to prevent dengue fever. And then, again, delivering of a product into the hands. This is the life boy. Then it also was an aha about, gosh, what else can we do? Sure, this person who's taking the survey benefits, but how can we also benefit the community as a whole anymore? So we actually would hand out an invitation to come to a seminar. And the seminar was very related to what the topic was. So in the case of Unilever, you heard them speaking about the seminars. This is one of the Johnson & Johnson seminars on dengue fever, another one on Unilever's water treatment and hygiene. And long story short, we almost got ran out of buildings because they had so many people show up. Because we also put in a raffle for a Purette water purifier, things like that. So again, trying to make it a win-win for the company, but as well as for the entity. Now we've all expanded a couple of years ago to the United States, and that's where I'll end, because we're looking to see what else we can do in our own backyard. As you guys know, there's a developing country that's pretty emerging here as well. And we started in East Harlem, and it started with a nutrition project. This too was with Unilever. And we negotiated with Unilever a couple of things. You know, again, back to social returns. What could Unilever around nutrition do? And one thing was negotiating that they would give an unlimited metro card to everybody who participates. Well, that was the mobile agents almost went nuts because everybody was following them home saying, will you come survey me? Opposite problem most people have, right? They usually can't get enough people to be interviewed, but the incentives matter, right? And making an incentive that matters to the people and improves their lives was so critical. And then the other two things were negotiated were cooking classes with the objective of trying to get people to have more vegetables in their diet because the research also showed that they thought they were eating healthy, but they actually weren't. And then negotiated having an urban farm that was put into the public housing complex. This is the Wagner houses. I don't know if anybody's from New York. Anybody here from New York? There's got to be people from New York. Okay. Do you know East Harlem? Mm-hmm. Do you know the Wagner houses? So about 22 buildings. By the way, guys, officially 7,000 people live there. Unofficially, 10,000, according to the community. We have the head of the Tenants Association. So we have a similar issue in the United States, right? So, yeah. So this, if you go to the Wagner houses, this garden still continues. It's been outsourced to an entity. We don't do gardens, right? We just do before and after needs assessments and impact measurements. But it's still going, and it's something that for the community. What we found when the impact study was fascinating, people initially were so suspicious. Why are they doing this? Evidently, Trump had walked through there a few years ago because it's incredible real estate. It's right there on the East River, and then there's what's the road that goes, 125th, right? It goes on to LaGuardia Airport. So it's a great location. And that means from that moment, everyone's been paranoid about losing their homes. But you know, why are they coming to spruce up the land? People were very, very suspicious of that for a long time. Anyway, these are the kind of insights that you probably wouldn't get if you were just doing a paper, survey or telephone survey. And by the way, speaking of that, and then I'll wind up. We did look to see who does paper surveys and who does online telephone surveys, because that's become more and more common as a way to collect data. And I'm sure a lot of you are sitting there, why don't we just SMS people and whatnot? But what we're finding, we've highlighted this too, people are very suspicious of someone they don't know. And when it came to an internet survey, the majority of the people we initially asked in Wagner go to, don't have internet access, or they have to go to like a public library to get it. So chances are they're not going to sit there and fill out a survey. And then as far as the phones, many, like the majority are prepaid phones, because we collected that on the surveys as well. So once again, are you going to sit on a prepaid phone call? It happened in Brazil too, 85% of Vivo and all the companies, are all their revenue comes from prepaid phone cards. So again, are you going to sit on a prepaid phone card and do a survey? So it becomes a lot more complicated to reach the base of the pyramid that way. And these are just some of the organizations, companies we've worked with, and what the different things, again, kind of expanding beyond health, if you will, into things like energy and solar and whatnot. The same methodology is similar. And I'll just leave with our core values. This is kind of what it was all founded upon. And these were on early days with meetings with Stanford students and the team here. Basically, we believed in investing in people, and that was the key to creating a business opportunity, but in their own neighborhoods. And you're hearing a lot of that come to fruition now. A lot of people are talking about place-based funding and getting entrepreneurs, local entrepreneurs up and going. It's kind of getting back to that. And then we believed in that win-win between the communities and the people who are actually paying for the data to make sure that we kind of strike that balance. And then lastly, our core belief is that, fundamentally, the first step to solving any social issue is accurate data. And what's next is we're looking at Middle America right now. So, thanks to all you guys. Many people thank you for listening and supporting. And we'll do questions. Some applause till we get to 4 billion, okay? Any questions about it? Yes.
You did mention, like, with the MetroCard, that there are often, like, incentives that people do want to come up and, like, sign up for the survey. But then there also must be, like, significant disincentives to, like, provide data. Like, off the top of my head, if you're, like, facing deportation and you don't want to, like, share that kind of data, what happens, like, when you can't accurately capture?
Yeah. Well, A, by having people in the community asking, that helps. We don't ask if they're documented or not documented, and that's not part of it. And I should say one really important thing on that note. We never, and this is really timely, given that, Zuckerberg is just, interviewing, so data is, like, really on everybody's mind right now. From day one, we grappled with that. This is even before big data became an issue, hot thing. But we knew from the get-go, especially because these people are already vulnerable enough, we never wanted to give out personal data. We will collect it only for the reason because we have to go back and do an impact at that same person, same house, right, to measure if the needles move. But we will never, so it's only aggregated data that goes out there. That often puts people at ease. And they're told that right at the very beginning, that, that will always be encrypted and whatnot. So we don't even, our researchers don't even look at personal data. The only people that do are the field staff in order to deploy people to collect from that. And the other thing is random samples, right? So most of the clients want random representative, which means you're taking a spattering. Let's say if we were going to survey this room about something, then it would be a random kind of thing across all levels. In the case of the favela, we wanted to make sure it was people from the lower part of the favela, all aspects of the favela, not just what's easy on the bottom, because in Brazil, just the opposite of what it is in San Francisco. To live at the bottom of the favela is the wealthy and the poor at the top. Because who wants to carry groceries or furniture or maybe not have the services at the top of the favela? So that became really important to do the randomized. So. And that's built into the methodology to make sure it's safe to randomize. Does that answer your question? Yes.
You mentioned that a lot of the accuracy comes from the hiring and training process. Can you speak a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so the first step for us is always identifying community leaders. Every community, guys, has a community leader. Someone who's either self-appointed by like maybe starting their own nonprofit to service the community. Could be someone who's of respect. Could be someone elected, although we tend to steer away from that, particularly in Brazil. because the elected ones oftentimes did have relationships with the gang, because they have to do a kickback to the gang to operate sometimes to get elected. So, but it's identifying those really well-respected community leaders, which then shortlists, because they know the community best, right, the potential mobile agents, and then we go in and do a final round of hiring. They're in training for at least, you know, 2 weeks at least, very intensive, before, and they have to do certain role plays and all kinds of learning, 4 different basic skills, you know, from professionalism all the way to, you know, data collection, right? And then having to be put through many, many role play tasks before they become a mobile agent. So there's various ways that they can get that in. Then when it's one that's in the field, there's various levels of quality control. The software itself can control if you put that the father is younger than the son, it's going to kick it out and say, sorry, you know, go back and redo that. But there's also ways, because we're collecting their cell phone numbers and whatnot, we'll have people in a call center of sorts that can call back in and double check the data in the local language, in the local dialect. Because we've also found that that doesn't happen. People hang up on it. We had someone from Sao Paulo calling the Recife up in the Northeast, and when they heard the Sao Paulo accent, the person kept calling, kept getting hung up. So that was a client who wanted to call in, and so they ended up coming to us to have our local person talk so they would be hung up on. So that's that suspicion and that, you know, familiarity. So all of those are kind of forms of quality control built in. The mobile agents have a team leader as well, this from the community, who's also doing random checks, I should say. So that happens.
How long does the typical survey last? And like in that sense, how long does their employment last? Because I would assume it's not like they're getting a job that they're gonna be able to get further.
Survey questions, two ways to look at the how long the survey lasts. One is the questionnaire itself, but you never go over 45 minutes. Particularly in an environment like this, is very low distractions. The survey can last 10 months, you know, by the time you do pre and then you do post. We also engage and hire, by the way, a lot of the mobile agents to stay on for, you saw one slide where we've listed our services, like co-creation. We brought some of the frontline mobile agents, because you guys, they're the ones who are walking it. They then become the people that the community leader relies on, because many of the community leaders do too. Old to even go up the favela anymore, for example. Same in New York City. Even though it was an elevator, she was, so the mobile agents become the ear and eyes, and they become very valuable in helping design. So they'll get contracted on to come and do a focus group or come and do a co-creation session around a new product, right? More and more, we've noticed that the clients, and it started when one came to us and said, well, do you think, and they were kind of dancing around to ask this question, but they said, do you think your mobile agents would, be interested in being our sales distributors, you know? And being researcher, we have to have a real firewall between sales and research. But being that we're socially minded, we're like, you know, there's always more mobile agents coming up, right? So yes, if they leave our job, they could go on and sell for you guys. And a lot of them have done that, you know? But then we have to go through a whole process. Then another thing we're doing now is negotiating at the beginning with the company to at least interview for internships. So that we too are kind of trying to keep that where they can get employed or at least their learning is continuing. So for the really real good mobile agents who are really serious, there tends to be a lot of opportunities. We brought, half of our team has come up from the favela in Brazil, so 50% are from the community. Some had started as team leaders, and matter of fact, in Brazil, the guy who started as a team leader is now our head of operations for the whole country. So, and you know, he's great because he can just walk into the community and totally have relatedness. I can't do that, you know, but he just, you know, so it's, yeah.
Have any of your clients been nonprofits or NGOs? It seems like the work you do would align nicely with many of their missions.
Yes, we're now exploring more of that now. Vanderbilt University was one, but it's not, you know, it's more of a university academia than it is a typical nonprofit. We're in conversations with several now to expand into 5 Latin America countries. It's an NGO that's working with women entrepreneurs, so, and microfinance. So, don't know who they are, but anyway. So that's a real serious, stay tuned kind of thing. Because I think you're right, it's very lovely aligned. And the thing is, there you don't have to create an intervention. The work they do is already the intervention, you know? Whether it be microcredit or whatever, right? They're there for a reason. But they also need to show more and more to their funders or donors or investors that they're making impact. So by contracting a third party, independent third party like us or someone like us, they're able to say, look, you know, it's not just us saying it, here it is. One thing too on that same note, the community leaders, I told you we give the data back to them. I never even thought that they're now using that data for the same reasons. They're going up and saying, look, this is who we are. Don't take my word for it, but here's some data from an independent third party that says who we are, what we need. And they're putting that into their proposals and getting money, which I just think is just awesome, right? So. Yes?
I assume you're a nonprofit, but are the client revenues enough to sustain you? And how do you go about your own marketing to get new clients?
Yeah, great question. We are a nonprofit in Brazil, as an independent nonprofit there, as well as in the United States. That's been really interesting because when we set up, the impact investment and the four, what I would call four social profit scene, wasn't there. But once you're a nonprofit, you're a nonprofit. There are pros and cons either way, as you guys probably know. You can, as a nonprofit, because we have many conversations with our lawyer, you can, as a nonprofit, earn as much money as you want. There's no cap as long as it's in line with your mission. And there's a court case on this by NPR, National by PBS, because you know they were evidently earning all this money, and people were challenging them as being a nonprofit, but they were able to show it was in line with their mission, they were fine. So, which means you could also pay your employees whatever you want, right? So there's not that restraint. The restraints are more, and we lived it when we expanded to the United States, is where does your money come then from? Because Brazil, like many countries, have a law that you can't take money out of Brazil, which, again, one of my failures was understanding that before we set up. You can bring money into Brazil, but you can't take money out of Brazil. It's a nonprofit. So we were kind of handcuffed when we wanted to expand. And that's the advantage to being a for-profit, a for-social profit. Because you can get that, you know, unless you really sign on a contract that's probably way above and beyond, you know, so it was challenging. But because how we started was, again, as a nonprofit, so a lot of seed funding. We got the Equity Green Fellowship that Karen talked about last week and certain things like that that gave us that seed. And then back to your question, are we sustainable now? Yes. So the whole idea was let's wean ourselves off the grants so that we can fly on contracts and be fee-based. So that's the business model. But it's not without a lot of work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I have a question regarding your recruitment of mobile agents. So you did mention in the beginning that like sometimes government contracted agents were like apprehensive of entering the communities and stuff like that. So how is it that to recruit the mobile agents who do the work that you want them to do, how is it that you first enter the community and are able to recruit?
Yeah, that's a great one. Oh boy, a flood of memories comes back. Well, I think I told you the first day last week how sometimes social entrepreneurs wake up one day feeling like they're a visionary, then the first day, well, maybe within the hour that you're a mad person. Well, I kind of lived that when I went into these favelas because, again, back to the community leader, you cannot walk into, especially environments like that, and even in East Harlem, by the way, any community that has any element of danger, the relationship with the community leadership is key, and a respected leader. And then for the first, at least in Brazil, before we were hitting the ground, I was always escorted in, and our team was escorted in with some of the community leadership, which was because it's these communities, including in Harlem, right, are all word of mouth. They all know each other, very tight knit. And that, by the way, that's why I love working there. You can feel the energy and the community spirit when you walk in. It's wonderful. But the word of mouth spreads really quickly, who you are and what you're doing there. And you learn very quickly, transparency is key, honesty is key. Just tell them why you're there and what you want to do, the pros and cons, and let them choose. And if and then we ask them the question, would you want to champion this? Let's say you're a community leader. Would you want to champion this? And if they hesitate, then we will go in, because you know they don't have our back, nobody is, right? But to date, not really, no one's not wanted to champion, because hopefully they see a lot of upside to this. And it's paved the way for our work and, frankly, our safety. This is being filmed, so I don't know what I'm trying to say. But in the early days, it was scary because, again, I didn't know the nuances I know now. And I learned very quickly, though. I remember in those days, I was doing interviews myself with one other person for hiring mobile agents. And I remember in particular one mobile agent, a candidate, sitting in front of me, and we always ask the same one question, which is, why would you want this job? And he held up his hand and he said, because I've already lost those two fingers from a hand grenade in a war with the police. At that moment, back to a visionary or a mad person, right? If I hire him, and it doesn't work out, you know, it was clear that he had been in the gang. But if you don't hire him, you know, and then there's just this whole, like, aha moment of why else are we here? If it's not to give a chance on someone and see if this could work. Has anybody ever given a chance on you guys? Can you remember a time in your life where someone took a chance on you? How did it make you feel? Has anybody else had someone take a chance on you in your life? How did it make you feel?
Like I could do it.
So if you can imagine giving this guy his chance, he went off the charts as a mobile agent. He was like on it, you know, and just the accuracy, the numbers, the everything. And he went on to take his money and get himself into a computer training program at night, which later led to him to be able to go to a university, small university program. He ended up getting on, as took an MBA as he was working at AT&T subsidiary. Mind you, this guy was missing two fingers, and yet having to do whatever. And actually brought him to help with the training in New York, because I was very cognizant that our team, you know, may not be able to relate, because it would be a great experience for Seattle. And long story short, he ended up, when he was in New York, he told me that he had asked permission to get time off, but you know, he really wanted to do it because he was now working at NTT, which is the largest telecom company, it's Japanese, and overseeing 40 people. And he decided to tell his team at that moment his story, because till that moment, they didn't know he had grown up in a favela. And I was like, oh my gosh. And evidently, they just embraced him even more so for that. But that's the power in this. And I've seen it so many times. You know, there are a lot of Chiapas out there. Now, mind you, there are some that have fallen off that we had to let go, mainly in the training, but you get a good read on that. But there are more untapped human resources that are capable, but are getting glossed over and not given the opportunity, than the opposite.
What are some clients that you have had to turn away, and for what sorts of communities were they interested in?
Okay, well, one of them was a beverage company. It's bubbly. and not that they, you know, they have a great foundation to do good work, but it really came to us down to two things as our litmus test. One is the product itself. And in this case, we believed it wasn't healthy. And not that we want to play God, by the way, and decide, you know, who gets what, but I think we also have a social responsibility, because we have learned that, again, this opens a channel into these communities. And I've also seen what this particular company does once they got that access. And it's really disheartening, because there's already obesity and diabetes out in these communities. Another one was actually with Unilever itself, I can say this, and they wanted us to do ice cream in the favelas. And it was really interesting, not that I don't eat ice cream, and by the way, not that I don't have a bubbly beverage either from time to time, I do. It's about, you know, do you really want to push it and open that channel up in a really forceful way? And we said no to ice cream, which was interesting because the Brazilians on our team, it's kibom.
Yeah.
You grew up with it, right? For the Brazilians, it was a real emotional appeal because they grew up with it, whereas the Americans that were engaged were more thinking of it from the health standpoint and, the, again, the channel access. In a way, I was disappointed we didn't do it because it would have been interesting to be working with a perishable item to see how we could have done that. I just thought that was one of the ones we said no to. And as we're going forward, we have an ethics professor, actually, at Santa Clara University, and we're going with him because he used to be here in what was the program we went through called the GSBI, the World Social Benefit Institute, and kind of coaching us on, well, where's that line in the sand that we're going to draw? You know, obviously, weapons and tobacco and alcohol are some of the obvious ones, but then there's a lot more gray areas than that came on to us a lot quicker than we expected. And it's really an internal, who are we and who do we want to be? And honestly, I got to be able to sleep at night. So, you know, things like what happened today with Facebook, you know, makes you think about unintended consequences a lot more. And not that we're going to get it totally right, but we're trying to be more mindful about that, for sure.
For your expansion into Middle America, where are you planning on finding the people that you hire? And have you ever looked at ex-cons?
Ex-cons?
Yeah.
Well, a lot of them in Brazil, for sure.
Yeah.
You know? And matter of fact, we have them lined up to be interviewed because the word got out that we don't care of your background.
Right.
We're looking at you from today forward, you know, measuring on that. Sure, we want to see someone who's respected and you know that weighs into it, but. We're open to that. We haven't actively gone after it, but we've been approached by different organizations who work with ex-cons, for sure. As far as where in the United States, Middle America, we're looking at, I just showed it really briefly, but these are the four regions.
I mean, where are you looking to hire
It would be in those areas,
yeah,
for sure. Because an accent and whatnot sometimes.
So how will you identify the regions? You'll just go into the communities and
our typical approach is looking for the community leadership, mm-hmm. and then that lead, it's funny how that mushroom. And then we can get to that. It usually takes us 2 weeks before we're ready to start interviewing. It's that fast. But people's reputation precedes them. You know, if you get into Mobile in Alabama or somewhere deep in the Midwest, you start hearing the same names pop up. And, you know, internet gets you so far, and then you really have to kind of assess, you know, what people know or they don't know about somebody. And that's our first litmus test, and then we kind of obviously call them and meet with them, and it goes from there. So, but yeah, so we're really looking for local tentacles, you know, because you can't do any of this work unless you have that local championship and the tentacles that get you. I should say, too, that's one project is this Middle America project. The interventions would be around entrepreneurship training, back to some homegrown entrepreneurs. And then another one I just love is actually in the middle of Missouri, and it's the Tuskegee of the Midwest. It was the first Afro-American vocational high school. And in Operation 1900, 1956, and Brown versus Board of Education, right, segregation ended. But a lot of the alumni from that school and their descendants are wanting to resurrect that school and make it into, because it was 120 acres and 12 buildings, and the structures are still great, but they're looking to see about what, you know, we would look at a before and after as well. It would be the purpose of it would go back to its original mission of reinventing the future of agriculture. But not just for African Americans, but for anybody in that vicinity. Because all the farmers in that area right now are really dependent on soybeans and corn, but the margins are going like that. I don't know if you guys heard about 2 months ago, the highest number of suicide rates in the United States now are American farmers. So there's a real have not left behind being ignored feeling, and we feel that they need to be listened to and their voices need to be heard. Most city slickers, whether it be from Kansas City or the Bay Area, New York, just it's a disconnect. So we're trying to engage that conversation. I think I'm getting the pain. You guys, thank you very much. It helps see some of you.